This is a tidal notch. It was formed around 125,000 years ago during the last interglacial period, known as Marine Isotopic Stage 5. It stretches the length of the Sicilian coastline in the middle of the Mediterranean. The formation of this tidal notch is closely linked to the tidal level, and it tells us that sea level at the time was around 7 meters higher than it is today. The temperature of the planet was an average of 3 to 5 degrees warmer. Ice caps at the two poles were reduced to a minimum. In Greenland, they had virtually disappeared. In the course of the coming century, or not much more, all the glaciers at the North Pole may melt once again due to the release of greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. According to NASA's satellite observations, Greenland's ice is diminishing at an unexpectedly rapid rate, over 239 cubic kilometers per year. If the entire sheet disappears, global sea levels will rise by 6 meters. And we would return to landscapes similar to those of 125,000 years ago. Will mankind be able to stop in time? And what climate can we realistically expect in the future? We are on Easter Island in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, an area of Polynesian cultural influence. This is the archaeological site of Kongoriki, one of the most famous sites in the world. Here we can see Moai stone statues, remnants of the civilization of the Rapa Nui, the inhabitants of the island. To increase agricultural production, the Rapa Nui deforested more and more of the island to a point where there are very few trees remaining. This led to the erosion of soils no longer protected from rain by vegetation, and to a reduction in agricultural production and consequently to a period of recession for the island's civilization. However, at the time there were no paleoclimatic data available, nor computers or programs able to provide indications of future scenarios. Until a few decades ago, climate studies were carried out using simple observational data, and it was virtually impossible to make predictions based on theoretical knowledge. Even if the behavior of gases and the movement of air masses in the atmosphere have been well known for some time, as well as their interactions with the sun, scientists were not able to simultaneously describe the various systems at play. Now, thanks to computers, these systems have been transformed into equations, and calculation models enable them to communicate with each other. This allows us to hypothesize about future climatic conditions. While these simulators employ the most sophisticated computers, the software must be taught to take the countless natural variables at play into account. To do this, scientists need to test the models, comparing them with real situations simulating the past. The greater the length of the period studied, the more success the models will have in taking account of natural variability in their long-range predictions. So researchers need historical data series to test their models. Satellites are able to measure environmental conditions such as the surface temperature of the sea. They have been providing this data for no more than 20 years. Ocean cruises and commercial ships cover very narrow tracts of the sea worldwide, collecting patchy information. In order to obtain long historical data series from the poles to tropical oceans, research has been conducted on so-called natural archives. These are fossilized organisms, or sedimentary deposits, capable of internally recording the paleoclimatic history of the place where they were formed, even for thousands of years. Research on new archives in the Mediterranean has only recently provided a significant input to the science. For example, studies on vermitids in the Mediterranean coral cladocera, which began at the beginning of the 90s, have enabled the creation of detailed reconstructions from 1500 to the present day. Thanks to this new information, forecast scenarios are becoming more and more reliable. The hypotheses for the coming 100 years examine how the various planetary systems, atmosphere, oceans, and biosphere, will react to future CO2 emissions, which in turn will depend on the rates of economic, social, and technological development of populations around the globe. If countries worldwide continue to develop at the current rate, by 2100 there will be between 2 and 5 times as much carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, with a dramatic effect on climatic conditions. During the last century, the average global temperature increased by 0.7 degrees. During the next 100 years, depending on the amount of greenhouse gases released by man into the atmosphere, the Earth's temperature could increase by between 1.1 and more than 6 degrees. But even with a return to the CO2 levels of 2000, temperatures may increase by as much as 1 degree. This warming will lead to a reduction in polar ice caps, to an increase in extreme events and heat waves. There will be an increase in tropical cyclones and an increase in rainfall in moderate and high latitudes. In Europe, there will be less precipitation in winter and it will shift towards the north. In the Alps, this will result in few snowfalls. It will become more and more difficult to have a long ski season. But is this really true? The idea that fossil fuels could affect the climate is no longer just an intuition. By the end of the 19th century, people were already beginning to imagine that the Earth's climate might be changing. But it wasn't until the 1980s that the effects of global warming began to be observed and to catch the world's attention. In 1988, the effect of greenhouse gases was recognized as the main cause of the increase in the Earth's temperature. The IPCC, or Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, was founded and picked up on the work of the United Nations Environmental Program and of the World Meteorological Organization. During the last 200 years, the combustion of coal, oil, and natural gas has continued the transfer of carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Current extraction of these fuels is around 7 billion tons per year. While oil reserves may be exhausted within a few decades, coal and gas will continue as an energy source for many years to come. There are enough coal deposits to meet energy production requirements for the next 400 years. Over 75% of coal deposits are located in the USA, Australia, India, and China. In addition, there are over 3,000 billion tons of methane hydrates, which have not yet been utilized. This is equivalent to twice the amount of all the other fossil fuels in the world. In order to reduce the emission of CO2 into the atmosphere, it will be necessary to think of more efficient methods of socio-economic development. At the current rate of industrial growth, CO2 emissions will double by the middle of the century. The effect of these global changes will not be limited to the atmosphere, but will also spread to the sea. More than 80% of the increased temperature of the world's climatic system is absorbed by the sea, even over 3,000 meters deep. Warming results in the thermal expansion of water, contributing to the rise in sea levels, which is also caused by the melting of ice sheets. The melting of Greenland's ice sheets alone would result in an increase in sea level of more than 6 meters. With such an increase, the sea would move inland tens of kilometers in many European countries, such as Holland and Germany. In the rest of the world, millions of people would be forced to leave coastal and island settlements. Many coral atolls would cease to exist. This catastrophic process would last hundreds of years, but the 2007 IPCC report already predicts a rise in sea level of between 18 and 59 centimeters by the end of this century. These global figures cannot be easily applied in areas such as the semi-enclosed Mediterranean Sea. This basin, in fact, has a number of specific geological and hydrological features which will cause sea level differences to vary considerably within a few kilometers, moving from one area to another. In the Tyrrhenian Sea, for example, archaeological remains from Roman piscinae, dating back 2,000 years, indicate that sea levels were 1 meter and 40 centimeters lower than today. But only part of this increase in sea level is due to climatic factors. The remainder is due to geological processes. Tide gauges indicate that sea levels have risen by around 18 centimeters over the past 100 years. In the Mediterranean, most of this increase occurred during the first 60 years, and sea levels have remained virtually unchanged in the last 40 years. While less catastrophic forecast scenarios are still being evaluated, the increase in sea level will produce negative effects on beaches, already a precarious asset. Sea level increases will exacerbate erosion already caused by other phenomena. The Kyoto Protocol and the more recent Bali Conference suggest that world governments should implement adequate adaptation policies in order to reduce the impact of both currently occurring and future changes through preventing their negative effects. On coastlines, for example, such policies lead to special planning to take account of the rise in sea level and the increase in extreme events. While in the Mediterranean, it's not a high-risk area for its residents, its coastal ecosystems are extremely vulnerable, and it suffers from a high rate of coastal erosion. Most recent estimates indicate that around 70 to 90% of beaches in the world suffer from erosion. There are areas such as the Niger River Delta, where the coastline is shrinking by 100 meters per year due to groundwater extraction, which leads to significant subsidence. We do not have reliable estimates for the Mediterranean, but we know that in Italy, 42% of beaches suffer from erosion, although the rate of erosion is not as high as indicated earlier. In this area, in the Ombrone River Delta, there are high rates of coastal retreat. The coastline has retreated by more than 1 kilometer since 1800, and the current rate of erosion is still 10 meters per year. In fact, these wet areas continue to expand every year, and this is due to the erosion of the dunes, which no longer protect the coastline from marine ingression, and due to subsidence, which is very significant in this area, and which contributes to the rise in sea level. In this area, it has been calculated that the relative rise in sea level is responsible for around 30% of current erosion. In addition to the disruption caused by erosion, if sea level rises according to predictions, this will submerge many coastal plains and deltas. In the coming 100 years, around 32 of the Italian coastal plains are at risk of flooding, as well as the long coastline between the Ravenna and Trieste, which includes the Venetian lagoon. Many of these areas are already at sea level, or even at 1, 2, or 3 meters below sea level. Every area is subject to different degrees of risk, since vertical movement due to isostasy, tectonics, and human-caused subsidence, which differ from one place to another, need to be added to eustatic increases. In order to determine what is likely to occur, each area must be studied separately. A number of groups of European researchers are working to come up with a common method for the zoning of coastal strips according to different levels of risk of marine ingression and extreme events. Risk charts analyze the morphology and the geology of the terrain. Foredunes, the width of beaches, and the size of low-lying areas near to shorelines are some of the factors which are studied in order to understand the susceptibility of the terrain to coastal disruption. The development of future climatic scenarios enables us to understand how the system might react to rising sea levels. It is possible, considering different scenarios over time, to map the areas which will end up below sea level, even if they will not necessarily be inundated with water. In densely populated areas, such as the Mediterranean coastline, infrastructure, tourism, and agriculture could suffer considerable damage. Analyzing the usage value of soil, houses and beaches, it is possible to calculate the potential economic losses and to evaluate where and when it is appropriate to intervene and save an area. These studies help governments and authorities to understand how they can maintain the best quality and usage of their coastal systems over time. In other words, adaptation to future climatic conditions. As well as affecting physical systems, global warming will also jeopardize the world's ecosystems and the organisms inhabiting them. One of the consequences of climatic change in tropical areas is the ability of barrier reefs to survive. The increase in water temperature leads to a phenomenon known as bleaching. The symbiotic algae living inside the polyp tissues of coral are unable to survive when a temperature threshold is exceeded, usually between 28 and 30 degrees centigrade. The coral lose part of their coloration due to the presence of these algae and appear to be bleached. This phenomenon could result in the disappearance of up to 80% of barrier reefs. The increase in carbon dioxide in the atmosphere corresponds to its increase in the ocean, altering pH levels.
What happens is that the CO2 is being dissolved in the oceans and forming carbonic acid, and the pH or acidity is increasing, or the acidity is increasing, the pH is decreasing. And as the atmospheric CO2 levels increase, then the acidity is likely to increase. Now the oceans are very important. They actually take up about half the CO2 that's been emitted. But so that's a good thing, but the bad thing for the oceans is that as the acidity increases, the ability of corals to make their calcium carbonate skeleton is decreased. This is because the carbonate ion concentration, which is a central part of the calcium carbonate skeleton, that the concentration decreases as the acidity increases.
Most coral will not be able to survive when a certain pH limit is exceeded. In the coldest seas, warming may alter the trophic chain. Species such as the great white shark and their prey, the seals, would no longer find conditions suitable for their survival. While this predator is reasonably cosmopolitan, it prefers cold or temperate waters, such as the length of the south coasts of Australia and South Africa. Even in the Mediterranean, warming may have significant effects on the distribution of habitats.
In
All of the species entering the Mediterranean from the Straits of Gibraltar and the Suez Canal are tropical or subtropical. This phenomenon has been defined as the tropicalization of the Mediterranean. In recent years, warmer water temperatures have been causing a dramatic increase in the number of alien species entering the Mediterranean Sea, as well as an increase in total numbers. These tropical species are now competing with the autochthonous species and are often caught by fishermen. There are no less than 973 alien vegetable and animal species in the Mediterranean. In particular, the migration of fish from the Red Sea has been fostered by the decrease in salinity of the Bitter Lakes located the length of the Suez Canal, which were previously inhospitable to nearly all life forms. Even the recent construction of the Aswan Dam has contributed to the tropicalization. The decreased flow of the Nile has permitted an increase in the salinity of the Western Mediterranean, making it very similar to that of the Red Sea. So alien species find themselves in an ideal environment. Another problem for the Mediterranean biodiversity related to the global warming is so-called meridionalization. This involves an increase in biomass and an expansion of the distribution range of thermophile fauna. This pertains to endemic organisms, which, preferring warmer waters, find new areas to occupy. These species, which previously inhabited the southern part of the Mediterranean Sea close to the African coastline, are now expanding progressively towards the north of the basin. Such is the case of the parrotfish, which previously only lived in waters surrounding Lampedusa, but which is now found right up to the Tuscan archipelago. And similarly, barracuda are now being fished in the northern Adriatic Sea. Mediterranean corals are accustomed to experiencing thermal stress, with strong variations in temperature within the course of the year. However, there are limits above which they cannot survive or multiply. For example, Cladocra cespitosa undergoes bleaching in temperatures above 25 to 26 degrees centigrade. Algal bloom and mucilage are other consequences of warming and have now been unequivocally correlated with an increase in sea temperatures. These phenomena, which have been particularly serious for tourism in the Adriatic Sea, have been occurring with greater frequency since the 80s. That is, since temperatures have started exceeding the seasonal average several times. The effects of warming are already having repercussions for mankind all around the globe. The government of Great Britain commissioned Nicholas Stern's work group at the Tyndall Centre for Climatic Change Research in Manchester to evaluate the possible socio-economic impacts of climate change currently occurring. The findings of the group are not in the least reassuring. An increase of just 1 degree Celsius would result in insufficient water resources for 50 million people and hundreds of thousands of victims of diseases related to warming, such as malaria.
Well, in the last year, we suffer because of the drought. There will be storms, and after another they come to clean the area, and we usually just accepting the drought on a September. But last year we have a blend of drought because of the wildebeest, and the rain, we have never get a rain from October, and we usually get a rain in October, and after now we get rains in October, the more the we get our cows get enough grass. But last year, no, we don't accept that drought because we usually get that rain on October. So the many cows die from January, from October to January. When we get a rain from January.
With an increase of 2 degrees, more than 15% of existing species would be at risk of extinction. With more than 3 degrees, sea level would increase by more than 30 centimeters, forcing over 170 million people in the world to abandon coastal areas. Many areas currently above sea level would be flooded with salt water. With more than 4 degrees, up to 50% of the world's species would probably become extinct. An increase of more than 5 degrees would constitute the greatest increase in temperature from the last ice age to the present day, and would result in environmental devastation. But with climate changes currently underway, are there real risks for the world's inhabitants? If we consider what occurred during the summer of 2003, analyzing data on summer mortality rates in the main European cities, it is clear that a particularly intense heat wave can result in a significant increase in death rates. In Paris, in August of the same year, temperatures rose from 25 to 40 degrees within the space of a few days. This resulted in the average number of deaths per day increasing from 150 to 850. Every city or geographical situation has its own differing capacity to counter extreme phenomena. This is due to the individual climatic history of each region, the adequacy of services, and the habits and practices of its inhabitants. The ability to adapt to climate change will be a crucial factor in maintaining societies and quality of life as we know them today. It is currently indisputable that the increase of greenhouse gases is contributing to the overheating of the Earth. However, in addition to adapting to probable future conditions, what can we do to stop our planet from reaching boiling point? As indicated in the Kyoto Protocol, mitigation strategies must be implemented. That is, drastically reducing the emission of greenhouse gases. Every year, almost 50 billion tons of CO2 end up in the atmosphere. This number must be reduced, and reduced fast. Current technology could already enable savings equal to 26 billion tons per year, with industrial models consisting of reduced consumption, renewable energy sources, efficient public transport, manufacturing cleaner motors, and ecological housing. The true challenge for mitigation is in the capture and containment of CO2 released into the atmosphere from coal-fired power plants and manufacturing processes. But where could this CO2 be stored? Exhausted oil fields, non-exploitable coal fields, or sealing layers can be used for this purpose. The IPCC indicates that at least 2,000 million tons of CO2 could be stored on our planet. That is 40 times the amount of carbon dioxide released each year. Another possibility is the biological pump.
The biological pump, what it is, it's a process, very simple process, by which a phytoplankton at the surface of the ocean uses CO2, carbon dioxide, and this CO2 then sinks to the deep sea. Most of it is used by zooplankton and is destroyed by bacteria, but a very small fraction of it, less than 1%, is stored in the sediment. This is the biological pump, which uses CO2 from the surface and transfers the carbon in the deep sea for storage.
In some areas, such as the subarctic and equatorial Pacific, which are characterized by a high concentration of nitrogen and phosphorus, but low levels of chlorophyll, the primary production of phytoplankton is limited by iron levels. Initial culture experiments have shown that phytoplankton productivity increases dramatically with the addition of iron. Currently, 12 research institutes are engaged in fertilization experiments to study the possibility of adding large quantities of iron to the ocean to increase phytoplankton bloom.
Now, commercial companies want to use this process to sell credits or to earn money from the credit system. And they plan to do large-scale, very large-scale iron fertilization to stimulate the biological pump and soak up CO2 from the atmosphere and transfer it into the ocean. There are several problems with that, scientific problems which are not sorted out yet. The first one is that we don't know the consequences of the input of more organic carbon in the ocean. And in fact, it can be counterproductive. For example, if we add a lot of organic carbon in some areas, we can have in the deep sea suboxic or anoxic areas with bacteria which will release methane and nitrous oxide, which are greenhouse gases much worse than CO2. So that's a possibility which has not been taken into account by the commercial companies wanting to do large-scale iron fertilization. Also, we know that changing the proportion of nutrients changes the quality of the phytoplankton, and this may have consequences on the food chain, on fish and mammals. This we don't know. We need to study those areas.
The biggest industrial nations in the world seem to focus on the following solution. Geological storage will be one of the technologies which can benefit from the system of emission credits in the emission trading system. Point Carbon, the largest center for studies on the carbon dioxide market, estimates that the turnover of emissions trading will attain €34 billion in 2010, the equivalent of 4.5 billion tons of carbon dioxide. This would ensure that the rate of global emissions does not increase further. However, the temperature of the planet would still continue to rise. According to some analysts, an increase of between 2.2 and 4 degrees may still occur. Stabilizing the temperature at this level would imply that we were not able to develop a truly sustainable global model. The climate is changing in a way that has not occurred previously in the history of mankind. This will have disastrous effects on the world's inhabitants. Is this enough to make us take the necessary preventative measures? If the inhabitants of Easter Island had had access to mathematical models capable of predicting future scenarios, would they have used them? Would they have taken heed of the alarm bells? Or are human instincts for a technologically advanced future and the corresponding perceived state of well-being, even if it is short-lived, too strong for us to consider the consequences of our own actions? In other words, if the Rapa Nui had had access to computers and mathematical models, would they have saved the forest from total destruction? Probably not. However, in the 21st century, possibly for the first time in the history of mankind, we possess an adequate level of cultural awareness and the technological capability to understand how important it is for our future to save the environment in which we live.